It's about 20 years after the crucifixion, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, is living at Ephesus, where she's being both guarded and protected by two men who maybe figures such as St. John or St. Paul. I mean, figures who have seen the possibility of Christianity spreading and are writing the Gospels. She, of course, is illiterate. And for them, the important thing is to write the story so that it will matter in the world. For her, the story is personal. And she has been silent on the matter. She's old. It's in her heart, it's in her body what happened. She's traumatized. And one day when they're out, she starts to speak. She's not spoken before. She's not told this story before, and she won't tell it again. This will be the only time she will speak. And what she wants to go over is a thing that for her remains deeply unresolved, is what happened to her son, how it happened, what it meant, what it looked like on the day. The novel is a secular space. It's much better with colors, with money, with inheritance, with things in a kitchen, with objects, than it is, for example, with divinity or miracles. So this novel treads very carefully among material things, where what Mary remembers at certain moments was that her shoe was hurting her, or she remembers a color, or she remembers a particular thing that she noticed. But of course, the divinity won't go away. I mean, the spiritual element just won't go away. I didn't really intend to write the Lazarus story at such length, which is from St. John's Gospel, but it's such a powerful story that without looking at the Gospel again, I just began to write the story of imagining a young man, much loved by everyone, who died, whose sisters were lamenting. And then when Jesus came, Jesus decided to raise him from the dead after 4 days. And Mary describes this, a story she heard from story, people talking and talking, the story comes to her, and she sees Lazarus alive. And of course, Lazarus now is in possession of information no one else has, which is where the dead go, what happens. And so that becomes part of the book, as indeed at the end when they confront her. I mean, the moment for her that she remembers most is them trying to get her son's arm so they could crucify him, pulling it back on the cross. The details like that remain in her heart. But at the end, they explain to her, he came to redeem the world. The world, she says, all of it. The world, yes. And then she says, the dead will live forever, but will we live forever? Yes, when we die, So those things are too big for her. What she remembers are the small things. But then, of course, by the end of the book, she is in Ephesus, which is so filled with statuary, so filled with powerful images. And the images begin to have an effect on her, in almost ironically, as though she herself is moving towards becoming an icon. The icon of Artemis, the figure of Artemis, the great statues of Artemis that are there in that landscape, begin to almost speak to her or affect her or have some sort of effect on her. And so there is some sort of resolution in the book, but not the full resolution. She remains puzzled. She remains outside the center, the sort of coterie that were around Jesus. I mean, she never became one of his followers or one of his disciples. She was his mother, and she wanted to protect him. And she saw the very worst things happening, and she remembered them, and she never could get them out of her system. And that's the story of the book. Every year I read Henry James's novel, Portrait of a Lady, which is published in the early 1880s. And it's the story of Isabel Archer, who comes from America to England or to Europe and inherits some money and is now totally free to do whatever she wants in the world. She has a marvelously grand sensibility. She has great ambitions for herself in some realm, which is not entirely the material realm. I mean, she doesn't want to marry for rank, as other women in novels have done, for example, in Jane Austen. But eventually, she makes the biggest mistake you could possibly make. And then the second half of the novel, we watch her dealing with it. She's a tragic heroine. She's a great figure. She's a figure of sort of moral grandeur and great eloquence. And watching her being defeated and then watching her handling the defeat is really a great drama.